23 notes a second. That is the exact number of notes the famous pianist and teacher Isidore Philipp would have wanted you to play. At least if you were one of his students back in the days. In case you would wonder, that are no less than 1,380 notes per minute. If you as a pianist already have a low self-esteem because your teacher keeps pushing you for higher tempi that you feel are just impossible, or even hurt your arm, hand, neck or back in your daily attempt to achieve them, but never had the courage to share your doubts, then this video is for you, since I will cure you from that feeling once and for all. To start with the best part, which is an obvious truth you will not hear often if ever, not a single professional pianist living on this planet can reach the number of 23 notes a second, nor the slower 15 to 90 notes a second someone like Carl Czerny wants you to play. Not your teacher, not the greatest virtuoso on earth, no one.
But I'd like it a bit faster, wouldn't you? If you're the fastest in the world.
But is he being fast? Is that fast?
Yes.
It's not impressing me.
No. All right, so I agree.
Is there something else?
Yes. Do you want to hear the world record when he actually played?
Yeah, I'd like
that. Now listen to this. He hit 765 piano keys in 1 minute. So
if you do the maths on that, that's about
10
there's more than 10.
More than 10 a second.
12 a second.
So that's a lot, isn't it?
My God, how do you do that?
Well, how do you? But when you listen to it, it just doesn't sound.
Well, I need to hear it.
All right, have a listen.
I mean, who counted?
Well, I don't know.
Must have they had a slow-mo replay.
But anyway, he's huge. He's become a sensation.
Well, I don't like him.
They call him the fastest ivory tinker in the West.
I'm never going to.
Let's try 184. Messed up. That's getting more towards my top speed.
And so it's time to tackle this once and for all and look for the real reasons behind these tempo indications, because don't make a mistake, Isidore Philipp was one of the most influential pianists and teachers from the early 20th century, and he was very, I would say, extremely serious on his tempo indications, or in other words, his metronome indications. So stay with me in this series of four videos, of which this is the first, and I promise you not only a better understanding of the history of piano playing and piano technique, but a renewed feeling of pianistic power for you. Because yes, also you can play Czerny's School of Velocity in his extreme tempi, and Isidore Philipp is going to help us achieving that goal. So a few weeks ago, I shared with you this, what I called a mystery score, containing a selection of Clementi's Gradus ad Parnassum with a kind of unusual stamp on the first page, saying US copyright 1891 Richaud and Company. After I shot the video, I saw this edition actually was made as a reprint of a much earlier 19th century edition by Richaud, which I happen to have as well. Here it is. The plate numbers of both editions are the same, but the added introduction page has different number. On that first page, we see the initials of the responsible editor for this score. I.P.H., or in full, Isidore Philippe, student of the Chopin pupil Matthias, Saint-Saëns and close friend with many of the great musicians of his time, under which Claude Debussy as one of the closest. The essence of that story was the fact that Philippe not only kept the original Clementi marks and credited them as being actual realistic tempi, but in many cases he added his own tempo indications as well, substantially faster than what Clementi had in mind. The fact that Philippe explicitly wrote in the short preface here that all of the metronome numbers in this book were actual playing speeds, so not at all a kind of targets hanging as unreachable goals high in the sky as many pianists and piano teachers today tell you, that's a remarkable statement made around 1900. This is important enough to underline again. Isidore Philippe, right in this preface, as he did on other prefaces, that his metronome numbers are perfectly possible to reach. Remember that. Let's read the particular quote together again. It's an important piece in our tempo puzzle. Pour arriver à jouer ces études dans le mouvement indiqué, il faut travailler préalablement. Nous ne saurions trop insister sur ce point essentiel lentement et fort. Or in English meaning nothing else, and in order to arrive at the indicated tempi, that's the metronome numbers, one needs to practice very slow and forte. In these episodes, we will make clear that the statements of Philippe on the correctness of his metronome numbers, combined with lots of impossible metronome indications, indeed climbing as high to an unbelievably 23 notes a second, will prove that also for this man, who lived from 1863 to 1958, the historical metrical use of the metronome must have been still in use. When applying the metronome as a metrical time device, one does not take a single tick as the equivalent to the note value in the metronome equation, but rather two ticks, one, two, three, and so on.
Oh, this really hurts. Can't you count a little faster?
These two ticks serve as a unity of time, hence the term metrical, and hence the name of this device, metronome. As in earlier times, the up and down movement of the leading musician, in the Renaissance music for instance, was seen as one beat, or one Schlag in German. That these two ticks equal one unity, so represent one beat. And that this use of the metronome still was in practice in the middle of the 19th century needs no doubt. Read, for instance, the way Edward Joux describes this in 1838 in Paris. Yes, the place and time of Liszt and Chopin. I translate directly in English. One, or better, two oscillations of the pendulum, and by pendulum meaning the pendulum of the metronome as well, could be taken for a comparable unity. To show this binary unity that consists, so to speak, out of two movements, we use the sign which we call a crotchet. Without pretending of adhering to the crotchet in absolute duration, the crotchet only reminds us of the two movements more or less pressed, but isochrone, that is equal among themselves, by which they mark the unity. This quote by Joux is one of the most explicit descriptions of what we today call double beat, a practice that went back to the 16th century and perhaps even earlier. The implication of this to music from Mozart till Chopin and beyond indeed is immense. Hence, the often very emotional reactions of musicians when learning about something that is almost as obvious as the sun is rising every day. Adding to this, such a late, obviously clear practice of the same habit as by Isidore Philippe is opening a complete new chapter in this fascinating tempo research. An undeniable confirmation by Philippe that the metronome numbers of this edition, of his, this particular edition and others as well, are actual playing speeds, no unreachable targets, is an incredibly strong statement in our search for how people could have interpreted these metronome indications. Similar statements one finds very often in the 19th century, but not by someone who lived only a few generations before us, in a time, moreover, with much less interest in metronomic tempo indications. And Philippe wrote this more than once. Also in his exercises for the left hand, for instance, let's read this passage together, and I quote, "Le but de ces exercices est le perfectionnement et l'indépendance de la main gauche et du poignet gauche. Pour l'atteindre, il faut le travailler lentement tout d'abord, plus vite ensuite, jusqu'au mouvement du métronome indiqué." End of quote. In English, the goal of these exercises are the perfection of the independence of the left hand and the left wrist. In order to achieve it, one must practice slowly first, then faster, until the indicated metronome numbers are reached. End of quote. So in other words, exactly the same philosophy here as in the Clementis preface of his metronome numbers to be actual playing speeds. Seeing such strong confirmation on the accuracy of the given metronome numbers as late as early 20th century is a unique contribution in our tempo research. And of course, Philippe does not speak about the metrical use of the metronome, double beat or single beat, so to speak. Why would he mention something that for that generation still must have been crystal clear? As for instance, Raoul Pugno, the famous student of George Matthias, write in his book on Chopin in 1909 on Chopin's Nocturne Opus 15, number 2, and I quote, "Malgré l'indication du métronome, je pense que ce nocturne a généralement joué trop vite." So in other words, in spite of the metronome indication, I believe this piece is generally played much too fast. We'll come back to that important statement also in the light of the performance practice in the early 20th century, which indeed showed a kind of ambiguity. But here, Pugno implicitly say that the metronome number should be enough for musicians to know how fast to play this nocturne. Well, the metronome number is quoted in note 40 for this nocturne, given by Chopin, by the way. Pugno adds to that that his own tempo for this nocturne is 8th note, 52, almost double beat. But if that's not enough, he recorded this nocturne to showcase the statement in exactly half of the Chopin number, so 8th note 40 instead of quarter note 40, almost as if he checked the Chopin tempo right before recording. So just a quick in-between here while I'm editing this video for you to underline that this performance by Raoul Pugno of the Nocturne Opus 50 No. 2 in F-sharp major of Chopin is not just a slower performance compared to the metronome number, it's a performance in double beat. It's exactly the half. That's very interesting and it's very important to understand. Now, before you run to YouTube and search for early acoustical recordings, thinking that that generation to which Pugno belonged will give you a kind of impression of how Chopin or Liszt played, well, that's simply not true. I made some videos in the recent past and I will do in the future. They were not thinking in terms of keeping the tradition alive. However, sometimes in cases of Chopin Nocturnes and some other pieces to which they in a way were emotionally attached to that particular way of performing, you hear that sometimes, those echoes of a very far distance. My point is here in this video, I will come back to that, is that Pugno in his book is making clear that he's aware of this metronome mark of Chopin, quarter note 40, which he explains as 8th note 52 and 8th note 40 in his own performance. In other words, in one sentence, he gives Chopin's metronome mark of 40 quarter notes and his own metronome number 8th note 52 and 8th note 40 for his own performance. So he equals quarter note 40 with the double beat interpretation, and that's not everything. It's in one sentence without mentioning the different readings. Not a word from his editor, not a word from his contemporaries, so it's a fact that his contemporaries of Raul Pugno, 1909, were perfectly aware of the metronome numbers and double beat, which they themselves gave at that time, and that's the time in which it changed as single beat. So that's a fact, that's not an opinion, that's not a belief, that's not an assumption, that's a fact, and an important one. Now, we come back to that, but let's now return to Isidore Philippe. The reason why we can be so sure of this practice to be an actual fact exactly lies in the dozens and dozens of metronome numbers that no human ever will be able to actually play. Yes, 23 notes a second is an absolute record that in metrical sense still will give you a whopping 11.5 notes a second. But in the case of Philippe's etudes, it's beyond discussion that the majority of them are simply unplayable. Combine this with the absolute absence of any remark of his contemporaries about the fact that indeed these beats make no sense at all, and the only conclusion one can draw is that what is simply in front of us. Early 20th century, still there was a consistent use of that old Beethovenish way of using the metronome. And the best part of it all, our classical repertoire suddenly becomes so much more human. The gods Beethoven, Chopin, and others come down from high in the sky to talk and speak with us on equal terms. And you know what? That feels ridiculously good. Now, let's have a look to some of Philippe's own etudes. In his technical exercises, one could say that starting out in 16th notes already is slow enough when considering the tempo indications to be single beat. In the first exercise, one would start in single beat with 1.2 notes a second, which on its own is already very slow. In double beat, this would result obviously in half of that number, which is really, 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 really slow. Now, if we go to the other end of the spectrum, the tempo we are supposed to end this particular etude in requires a speed of almost 10 notes a second, which not a lot of pianists, even the virtuosos of today, will be able to do for the length of a complete etude. Certainly, if one takes the additional request by the author into consideration, that of the extreme rhythmical variations we are supposed to make. The fact the piece needs to be transposed, and also we must repeat the whole process with the left hand. It becomes clear that the demand of 10 notes per second actually is useless if still possible. In number 6, Philip increases the tempo even more. Here we must reach no less than 12 notes a second. I would like you to try that. A rather similar tempo with 11.2 notes a second in single beat, we see also in number 10. However, here one starts practicing in a tempo of 7.2 notes a second if the metronome number indeed were to be read in single beat. In double beat, that would still be rather fast, with 3.6 notes per second. Also here, with a request so typical for Philippe of making rhythmical variations, playing the etude with the left hand as well and transpose it. In this particular case, Philippe wants us to play the etude in C major as well, increasing the tempo to 132, which, if indeed Philippe would use the metronome in single beat, would result in a whopping tempo of 13.2 notes a second. I will not make the claim that absolutely nobody on this planet can play this, but it is something one can doubt to be possible. Yet again, we read nowhere that Philippe reserves these tempi for the absolute unique wonder boy or girl. Not even a single word about extremity of tempi. Do not go over this lightly. A speed of over 30 notes a second is rare in piano playing. This is a tempo of 198 beats per minute. Yes, 198. While playing 4 notes every single tick. So your fingers should give almost 800 pulses per minute. Even for a simple C major scale, this is a tempo that for most of us, if not for all of us, simply is impossible.
Let's try 184. That's getting more towards my top speeds.
Certainly, if you consider the fact of keeping this tempo up for a while. Let's return now to our Clementi mystery score. We can draw 3 objective conclusions. 1. Isidore Philippe validates the fact that these metronome numbers, these metronome marks, so to say, are actual, accurate, and exact tempo indications. 2. This implies that also the faster metronome marks he added are accurate and realistic tempo indications. And 3, the fact that he increased the Clementi numbers prove that in his opinion these original metronome marks were not fast enough. That's an important fact because Philippe confirms directly Clementi's tempi to be playable. And by the way, if someone tells you Clementi's tempi here are perfectly possible to play in single beat, in other words, according to our modern reading of his metronome numbers, please ask him or her to sit down and demonstrate, because they are not. Let me finish this episode by giving you a short overview of these new tempi Philippe had in mind for these Clementi etudes. A selection, I'll put the complete scan of the score on my website in the future. Exercise number 2, a constant speed of 13.6 notes a second. Exercise number 5, a constant speed of 10 notes a second. Exercise number 6, a constant speed of 9/3 a second. Exercise number 12, a constant speed of 12 notes a second. Exercise number 14, a constant speed of 11 notes a second. And the maximum number of notes per second we'll find in number 24. Here, Philippe wants you to perform at a constant rate of 14 notes. Yes, 14 notes a second. That's still far from our absolute record of 23 notes a second, but do me a favor if you're still in doubt here. Do pause this video, open your piano. To realize what 14 notes a second is, put your metronome on 208 and play a simple C major scale. Every single tick, and I'll demonstrate you what 208 is here on my metronome app, here. Every single tick, you'll have to hit 4 notes per metronome click. And remember, Don't just try 2 seconds. You'll have to keep going for 2 or 3 minutes, as this etude is no shorter than 4 pages. Let me know in the comments below what your experience is. Really looking forward to that. And oh, by the way, this tempo is still below what Czerny asks you in his famous School of Philosophy. So if you still are in doubt, those metronome numbers are to be read metrically. We live in another universum, I would say. So here we have a factum. A factum meaning a statement that needs to be solved or passed before anything else can be taken into consideration again. And also, if your teacher keeps asking you to push your tempi to unknown heights of speed, do confront him or her with this information. Certainly, at the conservatory, on a professional level, so to speak, these tempi, considered perfectly normal in the entire 19th century and also by Isidore Philippe, should be no problem for someone teaching on that level. They probably will when taking the historical approach into consideration, but they will either ask the right questions after giving this a try or simply deny the whole point. Listen, my purpose is not to convince you changing your habits or the way you play or want to play or simply the way you like to enjoy music, but that doesn't change the fact that if we cannot play these etudes in these tempi, particularly in the case of this edition, it puts a lot of pressure on the single beat interpretation of these tempi. Playing is the benchmark for tempo research. One needs always, no exception, start from the given metronome mark. Another great showcase is Philippe's interpretation of Chopin's famous C major etude, Opus 10 number 1. Click here if you'd like to find out more on this. We'll be discovering the 23 notes per second in episode 3. In the meantime, thank you for watching, subscribing to the channel, and then we see each other very soon again.